point. So, well, why don't we start off with the temporal bell, the idea of macro-realism and the temporal bell inequalities. So, macro-realism, Schrödinger's cat, basically. As you all are very well aware, the formalism of quantum mechanics under certain circumstances predicts, gives a description of a physical system, or strictly speaking, I guess one should be careful in one's language. Quantum mechanics really only ever describes ensembles. So we have to imagine that the physical system we're thinking of is a member of an ensemble. This may be in some cases actually not terribly realistic, particularly if we're talking about the universe as a whole. But let's imagine a whole ensemble of Schrödinger's cats inside closed boxes and so forth, and then, as you all very well aware, the formal description given by quantum mechanics of the situation, sure, it's not a simple quantum superposition of a dead state and a live state of the cat, but it is a formal description of two states of the universe, in one of which the cat is dead and in the other which she's alive. That appears prima facie to offend our normal common sense ideas that if we were to do the experiment in a statistically significant way, on each particular occasion we would see the said cat to be either definitely to be either alive or to be dead. And, okay, so that's obviously been around now for pretty much 80 years, isn't it now? And of course, the sort of standard argument that this is really not a problem is based on the idea of decoherence, and it's absolute rubbish. I think to see that it's absolute rubbish, we have to analyse the relationship of the meaning of a scientific theory or a scientific description to the evidence that that meaning or theory or interpretation is correct. So let's go back to our good old young slits experiment done, say, with electrons. Suppose I can just take a little quiz. You're not really statistically significant, but nevertheless, it's worth getting some kind of feeling for the answer. In a typical young slits situation, is it a correct statement that each individual electron or atom or whatever of the ensemble either goes through slit A or goes through slit B? How many of you vote yes for that? No one. How many of you vote no for that? God, I've got some people have opinions. Well, I suppose you... No, I mean, you could... actually, one possible response might be that the question doesn't really make any sense, I guess. Yeah. Okay, no, fine, we've got some no's. Good. Okay, now let's come to good old Schrödinger's cat. How many of you believe that if you could really do this experiment in a statistically significant way? Of course, luckily the animal protection societies have prevented us from doing so, but if we could, then is it a correct statement that before I take the lid off the box, each individual cat of this ensemble is definitely either dead or alive? How many of you believe, vote yes for that one? Well, maybe you all believe in quantum mechanics. Okay, yes, good, fine, yes. So going back to the young slits experiment, why do most of us, most of you, believe that the statement that each individual electron goes either goes through slit A or goes through slit B, why do you believe that that is incorrect? Well, I think most of you would say because of the phenomenon of interference, the fact that we see these rather clear interference patterns, and nowadays there are these videos from the late Dr. Tanimura's group, we actually see it, this pattern building up rather nicely. So we see these interference patterns, and without rather extreme contortions, it seems rather difficult to account for these patterns by the assumption that each individual electron did indeed go through one slit or the other. Crudely speaking, if that were the case, then give or take some caveats about experimental inaccuracies and so forth, you would expect that the pattern build-up would be the sum of the patterns for the individual slits, and you can actually show quite explicitly experimentally that's not the case. And of course, that's not the case. Yep. And you know, if you don't like the electron experiments, there are in some sense even more convincing ones with the neutron interferometry and so forth. Now, it is true that there are interpretations of quantum mechanics, like the Bohm-de Broglie model, which do maintain the assertion that each electron did go through one slit or the other. In other words, the position of an electron is in fact a well-defined variable. However, they do have to go through rather extreme contortions to defend this and make assumptions which at the end of the day seem to me essentially equivalent to the standard formulas of quantum mechanics. Incidentally, there's an interesting historical point there. Nowadays, people there's quite a bit of discussion of the Bohm de Broglie approach to quantum mechanics in the literature, particularly in the philosophical literature. And generally speaking, people use the words Bohm de Broglie interpretation or whatever, but sometimes they use the word Bohm de Broglie theory. And there's actually, I think, a non-trivial point involved there. If you look at the original papers of Bohm in the early 50s, and for that matter, well, I'm not so sure about de Broglie because de Broglie was never quite as quantitative as Bohm, but certainly in Bohm's papers in the early 50s, he had a theory of a hidden variable substrate underlying quantum mechanics. But the in these early papers, this theory gave results which were identical to those of quantum mechanics under most conditions. However, there were special conditions under which it did not give results equivalent to quantum mechanics. Crudely speaking, you had to do a number of different experiments on the same microscopic system in close succession, and in the theory there was some kind of relaxation time for the hidden variables. If you could do your experiments faster than that relaxation time, then you would expect to get results different from those of standard quantum mechanics. And he makes that prediction very clearly in his original papers. Now, a few years later, I think in the probably in the mid-60s, I don't remember exactly, Papalioulios did actually do an explicit test of the Bohm theory with this feature built into it. Now, of course, for the test to make any sense, you have to know, at least have an order of magnitude of the relaxation time of your hidden variables. And in his original paper, Bohm said, well, it has to be something sort of pretty universal. What quantity with the units of time can we think of that's pretty much universal under given thermodynamic conditions? So anyway, the answer is h bar over kt. and which, let me think, if I recall correctly, at room temperature is something like 10 to the minus 13 seconds. Now, if you're doing the experiment with photons, as Papalelos did, that means you've got to have a, let me think, well, 10 to the minus 13 seconds, that converts into, what, about a micro, I think, doesn't it? Something like that. Anyway, something which is small, but not so small as to be experimentally unattainable. So basically what Papalelos did was to put a beam of photons through three polarizers in quick succession, as it were. And hopefully the, we could certainly demonstrate that the time taken to transit this apparatus was less than h bar of a kt. And lo and behold, the results came out exactly according to quantum mechanics and not according to the Bohm hidden variable theory with this assumption. Okay, thank you very much. Good, thanks. So, somewhat surprisingly, I think, at that point, the I'm not sure about Bohm himself, because he, by that time, had wandered off into rather different, in a rather different direction, but the people who called themselves Bohmians, like Basil Hiley, like Detlef Dürr, and Shelley Goldstein, and so forth, they really sort of changed tactics, as it were. They said, okay, we... I don't know if they'd ever, in fact, really embraced the Bohm theory, but from then on, they decided to make it, as it were, an interpretation. That is, Bohmianism for them, for most, I think, people who call themselves Bohmians today, would be not a theory which makes predictions different from quantum mechanics, but simply an interpretation of quantum mechanics. Anyway, sorry, that was a bit of a long digression. Let's say, for most people, and certainly most people who are not Bohmians, the existence of the phenomenon of interference at the level of single electrons and atoms is a sufficient reason to deny the statement that each individual electron definitely went through slit A or definitely went through slit B. Okay, so far? Okay, now we go on from the microscopic up towards the macroscopic level, eventually ending up with good old Schrödinger's cat. As we...
Can I ask one question before you go into microscopic?
Sure.
Yeah, still at the microscopic level. I mean, the hidden variable theory, for example, like the Gleason's theorem, works at, you know, dimension, let's say, 3 or above. How about dimension 2 or 1?
Okay.
You know, what does it mean that the hidden variable theory... it's not violated? I mean, are there experimental...
Okay, in a two-dimensional Hilbert space, there's no particular difficulty in fixing up a... for any given quantum mechanical prediction, there's no particular difficulty in fixing up a hidden variable theory which will reproduce it. And that's, I mean, the most explicit case for which this can be worked out rather straightforwardly is photon polarization. So you have a two-dimensional Hilbert space there. You ask, can we fix up a hidden variable theory which will produce the usual Mayliss's law, etc., etc.? Answer, yes. That was shown very clearly by Bohm in his... Bell. In this paper in Reviews of Modern Physics in 1966, which was actually written before his famous paper proving Bell's theorem, but for various reasons didn't get published until later. There's an interesting point there, which I think has a lesson. Again, I hope people don't mind if I keep on going off at tangents and digressions, but because I think some of these is quite interesting. As you, many of you probably know, in the history of the research into the foundations of quantum mechanics, a very important role was played by von Neumann's book, Mathematical Foundations of Quantum Mechanics, which was, I think, published first in 1932. But however, it was not translated into English for quite some years later, and that may be relevant, as you'll see. Among other things, von Neumann did a lot of very nice things in that book. still well, very well worth reading from cover to cover. One of the things he did was to construct what most readers, at least, took as a proof that no hidden variable theory could reproduce the experimental predictions of quantum mechanics. And the I think to see roughly how this this proof works, let's just take the case of a spin a half, say, and you're going to measure its spin, its projection, along various axes, the z-axis, the x-axis, and something in between. I may slightly misrepresent von Neumann at this point because it's a long time since I actually read the original text. But if you were, he didn't actually take this simple model, but if you were to take this simple model, then the essential statement is that the measured value of the component of sigma in a direction theta in the xy plane is the measured value along the z-axis times cos theta plus the measured value along the x-axis times sine theta. Basically, he claims, would be true in a hidden variable theory. As I say, he formulates it in a more abstract way, but in this example, this is how it would come out. If that is the case, then since we know that the measured value along in the z direction is plus one or minus one whenever we do the measurement, we know that the measured value in the x direction is plus one or minus one whenever we do the measurement, and therefore it seemed to follow that the measured value along the theta direction is plus or minus cos theta, plus or minus sine theta, which clearly is not the case. If we do the measurement along that x, we're also going to get plus or minus one. As I say, I think once one's applied the argument to this rather simple example, as Bell did in his 1966 paper, then it's fairly obvious what the fallacy is. This statement here may be true of expectation values in quantum mechanics. It is not true, it's not by any means obviously necessarily true, of the actual measured values in a hidden variable theory. In fact, you know, we've all been exposed to decades worth of Bohr telling us that that it's essential to, as it were, consider the interaction of the measured particle with the measuring apparatus. Well, okay, if you take that seriously, then in a hidden variable theory, there's absolutely no reason to suppose that this is true. So, in some sense, incidentally, one other important, sort of historically important note. With one exception, until Bell made this point clearly in his 1966 paper, I think it's probably fair to say that von Neumann's argument had gone unchallenged for 34 years. That one exception is interesting. The author in question was Greta Hermann, who was not actually a professional physicist. She was a professional philosopher. And she wrote a long and somewhat unreadable paper, which basically took apart von Neumann's argument. Though in a way, unfortunately, it was written in a way which was, I think, not in some sense congenial for most practicing physicists. So it didn't really make the kind of impact that it might have made. But she was an early doubter. This is sometime about 1935, so rather soon after von Neumann's original paper, actually. So let's see, after a long digression, come back to the question of macro-realism. As I say, at the microscopic level, we believe that the formalism of quantum mechanics, we probably should separate this. We believe, most of us believe, that it is not a correct statement that each electron goes through one slit or the other, in a situation where the formulas of quantum mechanics ascribes non-zero amplitudes to each of these two poles, right? So now when we get to good old Schrödinger's cat, formally, the slightly naive description of the universe is as being in a quantum superposition of two states, in one of which the cat is alive and in one of which she's dead. And of course, all sorts of other things are correlated to that, right? That's actually a little too naive because of the uncertainty in various other initial conditions and so forth. At the end of the day, you really would have to describe even the universe by some kind of density matrix, but I think that's not an important complication. So you have, crudely speaking then, you have an amplitude for the universe to be in one state in which the cat is alive, an amplitude for her to be a state in which she's dead. Now, at this point, the decoherence argument comes in and says, yes, but if you the state of the cat is correlated with all sorts of other things, like the state of the radiation field, dot, 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 all sorts of things you're never going to be able to recover. When you trace over those, the experimental predictions you make are exactly as identical to those which you would have made by simply assuming that each particular cat of the ensemble is either dead or alive. You just don't know which. So in other words, it in some sense reduces to a classical probabilistic description. But, crucial point, nothing in the formalism of quantum mechanics has changed as you go from the level of the electron or the atom up to the level of the cat. Okay? At least most of us think that nothing has changed. At the microscopic level, you were not willing to ascribe a certain meaning to the formalism, namely the meaning that each individual electron goes through one slit or the other. You're not willing to do so because of the evidence against it. The evidence was in inference. By the time you get to the level of the cat, sure, the evidence in the form of interference has gone away. I mean, no one really doubts that it would be impossible to see in practice, to do an experiment in practice, which saw interference between the living and dead states of the cat, or the universe containing the cat. Does the fact that the evidence against a particular interpretation of the formalism has gone away mean that you are entitled to radically change your understanding of the meaning of the formalism? Okay, now my favourite analogue, which some of you have probably heard before, analogy. Suppose we have a murder trial. The accused, let us say, is accused of killing his wife, and there is a vital piece of evidence, say an axe with her blood all over it, his fingerprints all over it, dot, dot, dot. Everyone says for sure the guy's guilty. Halfway through the trial, that piece of evidence mysteriously disappears and is not recovered. Does that mean the guy has suddenly become innocent? I don't think so. In the same way, the fact that the evidence against a particular interpretation of the quantum formalism has gone away by the time you get to the level of the cat does not mean, in my mind at least, that you are entitled to drastically change your interpretation of the meaning of the formalism. So all these dozens, hundreds, whatever, of papers on decoherence, which, I mean, not in its technical aspects, I mean, for all sorts of good reasons for wanting to discuss decoherence and how effective or ineffective it is, et cetera, but all these dozens or hundreds of papers which claim that you can somehow use decoherence to solve the quantum measurement paradox are, to my mind, total rubbish. Anyone want to debate that at that point? Okay, so where does that leave us? Okay, it seems to me that it leaves us really with only two obvious possibilities. I should actually, well, there is a third, which I will perhaps try to come to eventually. provided that we don't, we're not prepared to radically modify certain other concepts about the physical world, which I think to most of us are rather dear, like, for example, the idea that the past can affect the present and the present can affect the future, but not vice versa, provided that we're not going to modify those, then I think we really only have two alternatives. One is to really take seriously the what I call the extreme statistical point of view, which simply says, look, you are taking all of this much too seriously. All that quantum mechanics, the formalism of quantum mechanics was ever meant to be, is a recipe. A simple recipe for calculating the outcome of various experiments. And if you press me, I mean the outcome at the genuinely macroscopic level, where I actually hear a click in my counter, I see something flash, whatever, okay? Beyond that, absolutely no meaning to the symbols. Have no more meaning than the formulae which the ancient Chaldeans are said to have used very successfully to predict eclipses. Simply symbols on a piece of paper which you manipulate to give you correct experimental predictions.
Can I throw your cleaver murderer analogy back at you, but in a reverse way?
Yes, sure.
We're willing to ascribe meaning to the macroscopic world. That's a kind of interpretation. Just because our direct experience goes away at the microscopic world, should we throw meaning out as well? Are we allowed to throw meaning out as well?
Sorry, I'm not quite sure that I understand you. What you're pointing
at. I don't know. It seems to me like you're saying quantum mechanics, mathematical formalism, doesn't allow us to ascribe meaning to the microscopic world.
To the macro.
Or to the macroscopic world.
I'm sorry. Did you say microscopic or
macroscopic?
Macro. So, I'm sorry. I'm having a little difficulty distinguishing the two vowels.
So, quantum mechanics, the formalism, does not allow us to ascribe interpretational meaning to the microscopic.
Microscopic, the world of electrons and atoms.
That's right. Is that what you're trying to say?
Not necessarily. No.
Okay, so maybe you should. Maybe I can. Maybe if you repeat, I can understand. I'm not sure I understand entirely what.
Okay, I think my thesis was that at the microscopic level, the level of electrons, whatever, the phenomenon, the sort of fairly well verified, experimentally verified phenomenon of interference prevented us from interpreting a superposition of quantum mechanical, of non-zero quantum mechanical amplitudes as saying that each individual system of the ensemble, as it were, did one thing or the other, went through one slit or the other. Okay? So by the time you, okay, then my argument went on. By the time I've got up to the level of the cat, whatever, the macroscopic level, then for sure the evidence has gone away, in the form of interference has gone away. However, nothing in the formalism of quantum mechanics has changed. We cannot, in my opinion, use the vanishing of the evidence to ascribe to the formalism at the macroscopic level any meaning other than we did it, that we're willing to do so at the microscopic level.
Sure, yeah. But now you've gone on to say we have two options.
Oh, yeah, fine. Okay, that's next. Okay,
yeah,
that's part of the argument.
The
okay.
You were
okay, so option number one then is to treat
exactly at this point. So we look back to, you know, the Bell's 1966 experiment. You know, when I hear, you know, your interpretation, you know, when von Neumann, you know, first there, I mean, it seems that the question still hasn't been settled, you know, it's a two polarizer. I mean, the hidden variable theory can still be valid.
A general hidden variable theory is still viable in the case of a two-dimensional Hilbert space, like that of a single photon, yes.
Right, so therefore, if you, again, you know, go back from the two-dimensional Hilbert space, going from, you know, a microscopic to the macroscopic. Well, I mean, is there an analog there?
I'm sorry, I'm not quite sure that I'm following you.
Okay, maybe I don't understand, you know, the two-dimensional Hilbert space experiment. which I believe you said.
Well, okay, so just think of the polarization of a single photon, so a single photon beam. Yep.
So
okay. The statement is that, okay, look, I think that perhaps it's a little confusing because I mentioned two different things. There is, Bohm did in his 1952 paper, essentially, he didn't explicitly deal with photons in those papers, but it was a very natural, in some sense, extension of it. So basically, he formulated a particular model, a particular hidden variable model, which included some kind of effective relaxation time for the hidden variables, etc. That made predictions different from those of standard quantum mechanics under proper conditions. It was tested under those conditions and refuted, at least with that, with that value of the parameters, etc. Bell showed in 1966 that it was entirely possible to formulate a, in the case of single photon polarization, formulate a hidden variable theory which under all circumstances would give agreement with quantum mechanics. Okay. Ergo, von Neumann's statement, or at least as normally interpreted, von Neumann's statement was simply wrong. Now, I think one should be fair to von Neumann. Sorry, your question?
When you finished saying whatever you're saying, okay. I wanted to pick up on a variant of what
Joel was saying. Okay, fine. So, okay. Well, I just want to make one more historical remark. One has to try to be fair to von Neumann, and there may actually be a rather, as it were, annoying point of linguistics that comes in here. When von Neumann, of course, originally wrote in German, and when he introduced explicitly an assumption which is in more formal language is essentially this here. It's not quite that, but it's essentially that. And he used some words, something like, let us now add to our still not quantum mechanical ansatz, okay? Now, ansatz has become now more as a technical term in English, but when he was originally using it in German, and when, some years later, the English translation came out, the word ansatz was translated as setup. And I think that was ambiguous. It may have led people to assume that von Neumann was putting, as it were, more store, he was putting more belief in this assumption than he really was. I think, in fact, in 2013, the correct translation of ansatz would be ansatz. it's an assumption. It's something which is not obvious. It's something which you add and so forth. But by translating it as a setup, I think that possibly the translator gave a slightly misleading interpretation. Unfortunately, of course, von Neumann is long departed, so we can't go back and ask him what he actually meant by this. But in any case, the important thing is that almost everyone who read his book interpreted it as a proof that that hidden variable theories could not reproduce results of quantum mechanics.
I just wanted to go back to the sort of axe murderer analogy.
Yes.
Is that really a good representation of a situation? Could it be more like you have a confession from the murderer,
but not
necessarily any direct evidence because you can't see stuff directly.
Okay. Yes.
And then the murderer or alleged murderer gets a lawyer, and the suspect retracts.
Yes.
Now, I think conventional jurisprudence, you can still use the confession and evidence, but it isn't a slam dunk that there will be a conviction. It's known that psychologically vulnerable people can be manipulated into confessing to stuff they have not done.
Yes,
by
yes, indeed.
Contrived questioning.
Yes.
Leading questions. Right?
Indeed, yes, yes, sure. Yeah.
And, you know, maybe some of the experiments that we do in quantum mechanics are such leading questions.
Oh, okay.
I have a variation of your analogy, and I want to know whether you think this one is more accurate or your original one, and if so, why?
I think to make your analogy work, one would surely have to assume that But somehow, as you went up from the level of the electron to the level of the cat, the predictions, the formal predictions of quantum mechanics actually started to fail to work. Wouldn't you? Wouldn't that be more the analogy in that case?
Could we even test that? I mean, how can you repeat that test?
We can test whether the formal predictions of quantum mechanics are working. No? Not as a cat, but we can, for example, on flux qubits.
Sure. Certainly test it on flux qubits because they're simple systems.
Well, okay. No, they're not simple systems, actually. They're only simple systems when...
Than a cat.
Sorry? Oh, so much simpler than a cat, agreed. Yeah.
I mean, the presumption you'd have to make is that there'd be some point in which, at which, you know, the physics somehow changes when you go up, right? And then
okay.
There's no...
Well, oh, well, okay, that's it, precisely.
If you want to make a truth claim, you have to have a procedure for deciding it.
Absolutely, yes. So I think that, in fact, this leads me on to my other alternative.
So my comment is a kind of agnosticism.
Uh-huh, good. Mm-hmm. Well, okay, let me perhaps go on to my second alternative, and then maybe it'll become clear whether it's related to what you're saying. The first one is quite simply, well, I would nowadays describe it as the quantum information theoretic point of view, because I find that an awful lot of people who sort of cut their teeth in the quantum information field do, if you really push them, fall back on this. And you can name some obvious exponents of this, like Chris Fuchs, to some extent like David Mermin, etc., etc. Okay, this point of view would simply say, you are just taking all this much too seriously. The only legitimate role for the formalism of quantum mechanics is as a calculational recipe. So give me your experiment, tell me your initial conditions, tell me the Hamiltonian or whatever. I will predict, I'll write down my symbols on a piece of paper, manipulate them according to all the standard textbook rules. At the end of the day, I will come out with predictions about the relative probabilities of occurrence of various really, really macroscopic things, like seeing a flash or hearing a click or whatever.
Okay. So I just, if it's all right, I mean, I don't know how much time we have, if you'd like to continue.
This is fun.
I mean, is the suggestion here that it is impossible to assign a meaningful interpretation to the behavior of subatomic particles, or just a rather small thing?
Well, Well, yes, indeed, yes. I mean, if you take this point of view seriously, that is certainly true, that you cannot, in some sense, give any meaningful description of the state of the world at the atomic or subatomic level. But it's also true that you cannot give any legitimate meaningful description at the macroscopic level, below the level of your direct observation.
Right.
And then somehow, we believe that we do see particular cats to be dead or alive, et cetera, et cetera. These states of affairs just emerge, and to ask what was the state of this particular cat before I opened the box and looked at her, in this, if you really take this point of view seriously, it's not just an unanswerable question; it's a meaningless question.
Additionally, it seems that you would have to. Maybe I didn't understand. You said that there is no. You can't assign interpretation at the macroscopic level either.
Right.
Right.
At any level,
you can't ascribe meaning to proposition. You can't assign truth values to any proposition. Then.
The only propositions, I think, to which it depends exactly how far you're prepared to take this.
Sure.
But
about the world or
anything, at least below the level of a pretty direct observation, like I actually saw this flash. I think I saw this flash in this counter or whatever.
Like if I say this, I'm getting you off. Say this chair is here as a proposition, right? And
okay.
Given this interpretation, you can't assign truth values to that. Right?
I think that's probably true, yes, if you really take it seriously.
Yeah.
Yes. Incidentally, this is actually not a particularly new point of view, at least at a sort of rather fuzzy qualitative level. How many of you, if any, have read Reichenbach's book, The Philosophical Foundations of Quantum Mechanics? It's worth reading, actually. Reichenbach, rather distinguished philosopher of science, or more philosopher more generally, he's originally a member of the Vienna Circle, and then emigrated to the US I think probably before the war. He wrote this book sometime in the 40s or 50s, I think. And to my mind, at least until relatively recently, it's, you know, if you think about it, as it were, the classical era of the foundations of quantum mechanics, which might last, oh, I don't know, from the early days up to maybe, I don't know, 1990 or something like that, I'd say that is the most sophisticated, or one of the most sophisticated treatments, in fact. And he basically is essentially taking this point of view. And he makes some important philosophical distinctions between between different possible interpretations of the statement. You know, there is this chair in front of me now, or whatever.
But this is not even a philosophical interpretation of quantum mechanics. This is a philosophical interpretation of science.
Oh yeah, absolutely. But
it's a capitulation to the difficulty of quantum mechanics, if anything.
The way he puts it, at least, I think, is that if all we ever had to deal with was good old classical mechanics, that is pre-quantum mechanics, then there are various interpretations of statements about the world. There are so-called exhaustive or restrictive interpretations. What quantum mechanics has told us is that we cannot make a totally exhaustive interpretation, in his language.
One quick 3 seconds question. You mentioned observations and, you know, measurements and all of this, and going from, you know, micro to macro, are we not somehow constrained, you know, by the way in which we do all these, you know, macroscopic consequence which I bring from perhaps an engineering experience, like in fluid mechanics, you know, we start from mechanical engineering. We do all the Newtonian equations, but then, you know, when we go into fluid mechanics, because of the observations that we need to make are restricted now,
sure,
to flow rate.
No, absolutely.
Example, then all of a sudden, you know, the foundation equations become something like a Navier-Stokes equation.
Sure.
In which case,
some
of the observations, like, you know, flow rate or whatever, becomes meaningless, for example, in the case of a turbulent flow.
Yeah.
So would not something like that also be happening in this case for microscopic and this thing because we are kind of like confined by kind of...
Oh, indeed. I mean, sure. If what you mean is that at the macroscopic level, there are, in some sense, the measurements which we are able to make are in some sense coarse-grained. For sure, yes, of course. But you see, I don't think that really helps with something like the Schrödinger's cat paradox. It's not that, as it were, the cat was approximately dead or approximately alive. She really is either dead or alive, and these two states are not that difficult to tell apart, actually.
Anything new, I'm thinking, saying we are doing one more point, because we are assuming, you know, in the microscopic world, all the things, the variables that we are talking about are positions and momentum and all of those. Well, we got this idea because we start actually from the macroscopic world, and we hold dear all these variables, position, momentum, because we can measure them, and then we project, you know, down into the microscopic world, and then, you know, get back up. So we have chosen another set of variables, like in the fluid mechanics case, instead of choosing flow rate, you know, would that help?
No, I don't think so. I don't quite see how it would with this particular paradox. I mean, how would you use this notion to deal with the cat paradox, or the cat situation, as some people might like to call it?
Maybe not as drastic as it is.
No, but I mean, that was the whole point of the original paradox. It is drastic. Okay, so coming to my second alternative. The second alternative seems to me to be that, in fact, quantum mechanics is simply not the whole truth about the physical world, that there are other laws of physics or other features which are not there in the quantum mechanical formalism and are not visible at the level of single electrons or atoms, but come in as we go up from there to the macroscopic world. Now, you say, okay, well, that sounds a nice, vague, general idea. Are there any specific implementations of this? And the answer is yes, there are, in fact. And the most best known of these, which perhaps some of you know about, is the so-called GRWP, theory, Girardi, Rimini, Weber, Pearl. This was, okay, the history of this is that way back in 1986, Girardi, Rimini and Weber published a paper concerning an alternative, a theory alternative to quantum mechanics. At the time, it had a lot of difficulty making traction because everyone, they wrote it, unfortunately, in such a way that it looks as if it was simply yet another theory of decoherence. It wasn't, in fact. It's very definitely an alternative theory to quantum mechanics, which is so constructed that at the microscopic level, because we have to discuss eventually what we mean exactly by that, but at the sort of typical level of experiments on single electrons or atoms, it was constructed so as to give essentially exactly the same results as quantum mechanics. But as you came up from there towards the macroscopic level, the corrections became more and more important, and by the time you get to something like a cat, they become all important, and the effect of these corrections, which are not there in the quantum mechanical formalism, is precisely to take a superposition of macroscopically distinct states and reduce it to one of its branches, not to a mixture. It's very crucial. It does not simply reduce the state of the system to some kind of mixture description for any specific case, any specific system, any specific run of the experiment. It actually reduces the state to one or the other of these. So at the end of the day, each individual cat is definitely either alive or dead.
So this statement about not going to mixed states distinguish it from the decoherence.
Conceptually it distinguishes it very sharply from decoherence. From the point of view of experimental consequences, so not unsurprisingly, it does not distinguish it.
When you say not a mixture, so it's definitely not something like 99% alive. 1%.
No. Each individual cat is either one or the other. 100%. Yes.
How does that as you scale up? Yes. How do you make that transition?
Okay. In fact, not. It turns out, and in fact, actually, that was as I said, this is GRW in 1986. Already by that time, Philip Pearl, who was working at Hamilton College and up in New York State, had been thinking along rather similar lines and published a few papers. And in there's a very, very nice paper by Pearl in 1989, which I would claim actually should be regarded as one of the classic papers of the foundations of physics in the modern era. It actually puts together his ideas with those of GRW. And what comes out very clearly, and come out to some extent in GRW already, is that you don't have to build into the theory in an artificial way the fact that quantum mechanics works at the microscale and fails at the macroscale. It comes out in a very natural way from the basic concepts of the theory.
Suppose you have some superposition description. I mean, maybe I just need to go look at the math. Mm. My intuition tells me that if you have some superposition description and you make some kind of scaling, right? Small system, you're going to be sort of one portion of it is going to get smaller and smaller in some limit, in a sense. If you understand what I mean?
Not entirely, I'm afraid.
So
it takes the gas some time to diffuse across the box.
What I mean to say is that there's a macroscopic description where you have a single object, a single state.
Right, right.
And then you have a microscopic description where you have a superposition of states, and those are not those are qualitatively different in a sense. If you have a superposition of states, right? When does one of them go to zero? Right.
Okay.
Hard edge in a way.
No, I don't really think so. What happens is that let's consider a single photon coming from the most distant quasar that we can see anywhere in the universe. Imagine that you take that photon and put it through, obviously in practice an ensemble of photons, but we put them through a Michelson interferometer with a baseline of say 100 meters. Okay. Quantum mechanics says that we ought to be able to see the standard interference phenomena. In some sense, the photons had two paths, these two paths are mutually interfering, etc. Well, fine. GRWP says the same, that because the effects, the X-ray effects which they induce at the level of a single photon are not significant, even over a billion years, whatever, they're still not significant.
Certainly.
Now, as you push this up, we go from the, let us say, from the photon, the superposition of states of the photon to states of, let us say, a fullerene molecule being diffracted through a, as they do in Vienna, through a Young-Slitz interference device. Okay, what GRWP would say is that very crudely, the effect, the non-quantum mechanical effects are now multiplied by a factor which, crudely speaking, is proportional to the number of elementary particles involved in the superposition. In this case, maybe 1,000 or so. Okay, go on, push it up further. By the time you get to the cat, the number of elementary particles which are behaving differently in the two states is, well, you know, 10 to the 23, 10 to the 25, whatever. Okay.
So but has this really solved our philosophical problem?
Well, in the sense that it's given us a prescription for a way. Incidentally, one thing I should say is that the whole formulation of GRWP is in the language of quantum mechanics. So basically you do have a wave function, but the actual dynamics of that wave function, the actual evolution in time, is different from what it is in standard quantum mechanics. And in particular, there are nonlinear terms which mean that if I start with a superposition, eventually, obviously you have to specify in what kind of basis, etc., but if I start off with the appropriate superposition, then eventually it's going to evolve into one of its branches. In a way which is certainly stochastic, but it is nevertheless objective, if you like. I do think that's an important distinction. Quantum mechanics, of course, lacks both determinism and objectivity, or at least normally interpreted it does. This is trying it still sacrifices the determinism, but keeps the objectivity, but restores the objectivity. Okay, so, that's the, as I say, that's a sort of generic possibility. GRWP is one specific example of how you might achieve it. But you can think more generally, I think. It sometimes helps, I think, to think more generally about possible theories of the world, which simply say that by the time you get up to a certain level of macroscopicity, or whatever, we can discuss in a moment what that means, by the time you get up to this certain level of macroscopicity, then macroscopic objects are in definite macroscopic states. Okay, why? Okay, that's a different question. We needn't discuss that for now. But let's just consider this class of theories, and let's call those theories macro-realistic. Okay, so let's take a very specific example, because this is the example on which most of the experiment, or the kind of example on which most of the experiments have been done. Let's consider a flux qubit. You have the usual setup. You confine yourself. You believe you can confine yourself. For the moment, let's just think about how we describe this in ordinary quantum mechanics. You have this superconducting ring with a single, well, maybe more than one, Josephson junctions in it. You put a flux through it, appropriate flux through it. It has two nearly degenerate states. Quantum mechanically, it can tunnel between them, so you get you get the possibility of quantum superpositions. These two states typically might be current circulating one way, clockwise or anticlockwise, in each case with a magnitude of the order of a few microamps, typically, in experiments. Okay, so let's imagine a macro-realistic theory which says, okay, I don't believe that. I don't believe you can have quantum superpositions of these. What I believe is that since this is basically a macroscopic object, I'll argue about how simple or not it is, but it at least it's in some sense at a reasonably macroscopic scale. I believe that by the time you got up to this kind of stage of macroscopicity, other laws of physics have come in, such as it's always definitely, apart from short transit times, which of course you have to allow for, but essentially it's always in one state or the other. Right? Now there you are. And when I first started thinking about this, which was right way back in the late 70s or early 80s, of course, you have to remember, not only were there no flux qubits, there was no quantum information, really, in those days. It didn't start till a bit later. But anyway, there were no experiments at this level. Okay, and so I started thinking, well, what kinds of experiments might we try to do to distinguish between these two possible conjectures? Conjecture number one, of course, is the one that probably most physicists would make, namely that at this sort of quasi-macroscopic, or whatever you want to call it, level, quantum mechanics will still work fine. Conjecture number two is that, no, something else will have come in by that point, and we will actually see the system behaving as if it was always in a definite macroscopic state. Okay, so how are we going to distinguish between those two possibilities? Or can we, in fact? Is it even a meaningful program to try to distinguish between these two conjectures? We got an awful lot of flack throughout the 80s and 90s from various people, mostly in departments of theoretical physics or philosophy of science or whatever, who said this whole idea is complete nonsense. You're just wasting. I think one senior theorist actually used the phrase "wasting the taxpayers' money." In fact, on this, always to that effect. Why? Well, because. What you are trying to do is to, what we can certainly agree about is that to the extent that by the time you've got to this kind of level, decoherence will always have come in and reduced your superpositions to mixtures, to the extent that that is true, then this will be a ridiculous program. Because every prediction that you would make on the basis of a macro-realistic theory is precisely the same prediction as would be made by standard quantum mechanics taking account of decoherence. That's the whole point. That's the whole point of the so-called decoherence resolution of the quantum measurement problem, that once decoherence has come in, the experimental predictions made by quantum mechanics are precisely the same as the experimental predictions which would be made by a macro-realistic theory. And as late as 1999, actually, there were quite distinguished senior people who were telling us, this is just not going to work. Well, I mean, I find it rather amusing that nowadays everyone just takes for granted that it does work. we've now had this program of experiments for the last 15 years or so, which have precisely shown that, apparently at least, you can distinguish you can create quantum superpositions of different states of your squid, which do appear to be sufficiently stable against decoherence, that you can use them in this program. As I say, not at all obvious in the 90s, whatever. Okay, so what might you actually try to do? Well, in other words, okay, what I think one can certainly say after 15 years of work on flux qubits and so forth, one can certainly say that everything is consistent with quantum mechanics still working. You apply the standard formalism, don't treat this macroscopic degree of freedom, the circulating flux or the current, as anything special, just apply the usual quantum mechanical prescriptions to it. Looks like everything works fine. But, of course, that really isn't quite the end of the story. What one would ideally like to do is not just to show that everything is consistent with quantum mechanics. I'm a Popperian in my philosophy of science. I don't believe that any finite set of experiments could ever demonstrate any theory to be true, including quantum mechanics. Okay? That's just a matter of simple logic. The fact that theory T predicts experimental result E, and I see experimental result E, does not prove that theory T is correct. Something which tends to be forgotten by experimentalists writing up their results in Physical Review, I should say. So what I'd rather like to do is to, rather than showing that quantum mechanics is true, which, as I say, I don't think one could ever do, I believe one could never do by any finite series of experiments, what we'd like to do is to show that a broad class of alternative theories to quantum mechanics is false. That's precisely what was done, of course, in the Bell's theorem area, very spectacularly, over the last 40 years. One would like to be able, in some sense, to replicate that here. OK, what class of theories? Well, crudely speaking, macro-realistic theories. So now let's try to define what we mean by a macro-realistic theory for a for the flux qubit. So you have your flux qubit, and it's, crudely speaking, a superconducting ring closed by a Jesusson junction, maybe more than one. And what you're comparing, the states you're trying to superpose are states in which the current is flowing clockwise in one case, anticlockwise in the other, with a magnitude of something like a few like microamps. OK, those who want to object that a few microamps is not very macroscopic, wait, I'll come back to that one. OK, so we'll now try to define a macro-realistic theory in the following way. Let's define a variable Q, which in general will be a function of time, in the following way. If we make a measurement of which of these two states is, this really is, hopefully, a relatively good a pure flux, pure qubit here. So we have two and only two states to worry about. So, and we can, in principle, we can measure which of these two states is occurring at any given time. And sure enough, I mean, this has been done many years ago. You know, you can actually go in with some kind of magnetometer. In fact, confusingly, it turns out that the magnetometer is usually itself a squid of a different type, but that's just, as I say, that's just confusing. So let's imagine that we just have this abstract measuring instrument. So we have this measuring instrument which will, which we can switch on, as it were, at any particular time and see whether it's circulating clockwise or anticlockwise. Okay. So let's, and if we see it circulating clockwise, let's say we'll define the variable Q at that particular time to be equal to plus one. If it's anticlockwise, it's minus one. That's just for notational convenience. Okay, now what we can, in a macro-realistic theory, what we assume is that one, Q of T, either, again, there's a technical complication due to the fact that we clearly have to allow short transit times, but be it noticed that whenever we do the actual measurement, we, as it were, always see, to one part in 10 to the 7, always see the system either clockwise or anticlockwise, never in between. So if there are transit times, they're extremely short, as it were. Either equals plus one or equals minus one, irrespective of observation, irrespective of whether it's being observed or not. As far as I know, at least, it would be impossible to test that hypothesis by itself. So we do need to supplement it.
So, i.e., just a short answer, there is no such thing as a metastable state?
No relevant metastable state here, no. As I say, we've been playing around with these flux qubits, as it were, at the semi-classical level for quite some time. I mean, for, I think, probably 40 years nearly now. So we do have a lot of knowledge of the sort of classical level electrical engineering which goes into them. And so, yeah.
If we use this language to talk about, for instance, electrons going through space,
right. Mm, all right.
There are ways in which we can test that first assertion, right? We see interference patterns.
But I think you'd have to make, even in that case, some supplementary assumptions. I doubt whether you could test that by itself. I mean, for example,
So we'd have to add, if one were to go into plus one or minus one, then we would expect this kind of pattern on the
Yeah, I think you'd have to make certain implicit assumptions about the additivity of the patterns and so forth. Okay, so the question is, what are the minimum supplementary assumptions one needs to make a meaningful test in this case? And I believe that at least there are, you need to add two things. Two is that non-invasive measurability, NIM. What does that mean? It means that at least in principle, it is possible to measure the variable Q without disturbing the system or affecting its subsequent motion. Now, crucial point, that is not a quantum mechanical assumption. That is a very non-quantum mechanical assumption, but it does seem, I think it's very almost a natural part of macro-realistic theory. Imagine that I have this pencil here, okay? If I'm a macro-realist, I say, at any particular time, it is either here or here, say. Imagine I just have it confine myself to those two states. Now imagine that I shine my flashlight here. If I see the pencil, well, then I can argue maybe I interfered with it, I affected it, I affected its subsequent motion. So I'm going to throw that run away. If, however, I did not see it, then I can argue that since, according to macro-realism, it had to be either here and here, and I did not see it here, then it must have been here. And if it's here, then I could not have affected it by shining my flashlight here. And if you now tell me that despite the fact that it really was here, I nevertheless affected it by shining my flashlight here, then I ask you what you mean by saying that it's there in the first place. I don't think it has really any meaning. So I think this is a very natural, non-invasive measurability, at least in principle, is a very natural consequence of macro-realism. Now, of course, this raises the big question how you'd actually know in real life, in a real experiment, that your measurement was non-invasive. We'll come back to that. Assumption three, which we actually left out in our original paper. This is we being Anupam and Gogadai in 1985. We actually left this one out in our original paper. We later realised that it probably was as well to add it explicitly. And this is what I usually call for a short induction, but what it really means is, as it were, the normal conceptions about the arrow of time, that the past can affect the present can affect the future, not vice versa. Turns out, actually, that's not so essential. You can, in fact, afford to reverse the error of time, provided that you do it consistently, and the experiment still works. But still, it's convenient to add that, since most people believe that anyway. OK, so let's call that induction, although it's not probably the best name for it. Causality. Causality. Well, yes. Yes, if you interpret it in that way, yes. Causal ordering, yes, I suppose causal ordering will do, yeah. Mm-hmm. Sure. Okay, but I think we know what we mean anyway. Yeah. Okay, given that, then it turns out that there is an almost trivial transcription to this situation of the famous CHSH inequality in the Bell's theorem context. The different polarizer settings are simply replaced by different times at which you do the measurement. Now, of course, there's no question of any kind of non-locality here. You're always dealing with a single spatially localized system, etc. But you can. The algebra is essentially identical, what it is, to the Bell's theorem, the CHSH case. And what you can prove is that Q of T2 plus Q of T3 plus Q of T4 minus Q of T4 is less than or equal to. Of course, that's not the most general form of CHSH, but it'll do for us. I say the algebra which goes into that, and essentially most of the steps in the argument are exactly parallel to the CHSH, except that the physical meaning of some of them is very different in many cases. But, okay, may I just take that as read, or do people want me to actually go through the proof? Okay. Now actually this is too complicated for our purposes, because in fact it turns out that we can actually set, for example, T2 equal to T3 without any great loss in this particular case. So we only need to deal with three times, not two. And so Well, of course, the punchline, as you of course will guess, is that for a simple isolated two-state system given by the standard Hamiltonian, which in this case, if my if the eigenstates of Q are sigma z, then my Hamiltonian might simply be minus delta times sigma x.
Can I just clarify, yep. the assumptions that lead to this inequality are these three
that
put here?
Okay. That's what I claim at least, yeah. I should say that this claim is not totally uncontroversial. There have been, there's been, in particular, my former colleagues at Illinois, sorry, name is slipping my mind. Come back to me. Okay. A couple of my colleagues at Illinois wrote a whole series of papers claiming that this was actually wrong, but I think their argument is in fact flawed. So I think most people, they may or may not think it's very significant, but I think most people do agree that the conclusion is correct. Okay, so now question, how are you actually going to do the experiment? And it really isn't as trivial as it might seem.
This is just the standard Leggett-Gart inequality.
Yeah, sometimes called the Leggett-Gart inequality. Yeah. Actually, it's more usually written in terms of three, only three times rather than four. Carl. Come back to me. So, how are you going to actually do the experiment? What I think you certainly do need to do is, as a minimum, to make all your measurements von Neumann, that is, projective measurements. There have been attempts, there's been one attempt about 2 years ago by the group at Saclay, it's Palacios Leloy et al., to do this experiment on a flux qubit. There were actually two problems with that, one of which I think is not so serious, and the other which is very serious. They claimed to have demonstrated a violation of that inequality. The minor problem with that experiment, I think, was that although the flux qubit in question was reasonably macroscopic in terms of actual geometrical dimensions and so forth, it was actually in some kind of quantronium setup, I think. It was a particular flux qubit with particular frills, as it were, and those frills were such that the two states which were actually allegedly superposed, that is, corresponding to q equals plus 1 or minus 1, were not really, by any reasonable criterion, macroscopically distinct. But I think that's something which one could get around fairly easily with a slightly different setup. A much more serious defect of that experiment, in my mind, was the fact they were using so-called weak measurement techniques. And it seems to me that these simply just from, as it were, from the ground up are simply not appropriate to this kind of experiment. You have to have definite yes-no outcomes or the whole thing really doesn't work. I think that they implicitly had to make an awful lot of supplementary assumptions to interpret their results as showing anything to do with this. And I wouldn't say myself that was satisfactory.
So, I don't know if you finished what you were going to say, but I mean, it sounds like you're not keen on the whole weak measurement thing.
I have slightly ambiguous views on weak measurement. No, I don't think it does at all.
What's
no.
the difference then?
A weak measurement is one in which, I would personally regard the term measurement as originally used by Albert Aharonov and Weidmann as somewhat misleading and inappropriate. One should talk about perhaps a weak interaction with the measuring device. What you're doing there is to set up the so-called measuring device in such a way that when the system interacts with it, it is only shifted by an amount which is small compared to its zero-point uncertainty, etc. That is not actually the idea of using a measuring device which is, as it were, very inefficient That's, of course, by no means novel to our open environment. I mean, experimentalists have been doing that for donkey's years, way before that. And they knew how to interpret the results of these things. What, I mean, I think the real novelty introduced by Aharonov and company was the idea of combining this with post-selection and getting out these really rather amazing results. And I you know, I'm absolutely nothing against that. I think it's done some great things, but I think to call this a weak measurement is really inappropriate.
Yeah, so back to again, the weak measurement. So the analogy of doing that inequality and showing that it's not violated, like in the NMR case, in T2 damping, you will have like the gamma term that comes violate the thing. So would the same term be in this case now?
Well, I mean, if you're asking, can I just rephrase your question so I can see if it's what you mean? If you're asking, doesn't this also work at the microscopic level? The answer is yes, certainly. And in fact, there have been a number of experiments over the last couple of years, both in quantum optics and in NMR, which have actually, not surprisingly, established that the inequality is violated at the microscopic level. But of course, that wasn't the original point. So.
That's what we'd expect.
Of course.
That microscopic objects can exist in superposition.
Yes, we certainly would, I think. So, I think these are, they're nice, but we've been really rather surprised if it came out any different.
So, basically then, in the microscopic term, you can, trace out the thing and write, use the same examples, MR, the T2 measurement, you have the gamma term. So, what becomes the gamma term when you elevate the thing from the microscopic?
I mean, you're asking, as I say, this inequality is violated by quantum mechanics for the ideal case, the case of an ideal isolated two-state system. That's rather trivial to show. When you actually have to worry about real mechanisms of decoherence, of course, then it's not so obvious. And certainly, you would expect there's a certain critical decoherence rate beyond which you no longer violate this. That will depend on the exact setup of the experiment, what your time intervals are, et cetera, et cetera. And in real life, if you're asking what are the sources of the equivalent of gamma, T2 to the minus 1, typically interaction with the black body radiation field, the 60 hertz background, all the things that experimentalists normally have to worry about. What's been quite surprising is that, let me just backtrack a moment. If in 1999, before there were any experiments along these lines, you'd asked me, suppose that we actually do this experiment, say, on Ramsey fringe. Don't worry about this experiment specifically. Let's just try to do a standard Ramsey fringe experiment on these flux qubits. What would you anticipate being the number of cycles you could reasonably see? And I'd have probably said in 1999, you'll be lucky if you see two or three. Luckily, that's enough to test this inequality. But still, I'd say you'd be lucky enough to see two or three. Nowadays, I see hundreds, literally. Quite serendipitous.
One quick question. Which goes back actually to the GRP, GRWP.
Yeah.
I mean, there they kind of postulate there is a background noise that move the things towards one branch
without
explicitly explaining where the background noise is.
Kind
of thought that the whole thing is kind of stochastic in nature.
That's right, yeah.
Which, one question, I come, ask from a stochastic point of view is, without knowing the nature, how do you know that? Because stochastics, unlike quantum mechanics, based on fundamental assumptions that there are cancellations from independent events. How do we know that those background noises are independent? For example, the 60 hertz is not certainly not independent.
No, but you have to remember that the GRWP background noise is really a peculiar object. I mean, it's as peculiar as the quantum mechanical wave function, if you like. Dr. Leung says, it's invoked to, you do invoke in GRWP this universal background noise, which is not itself described by quantum mechanics. And that's really the crucial point, I think. Once you allow it to be described by quantum mechanics, you just get back to the standard decoherence picture.
But it does assume a classical stochastic.
It assumes that the correlations are of a certain type, so Gaussian and whatever.
The distribution is independent.
That's right, so it's an assumption. That's right, it's an assumption. Just as, at the end of the day, Schrödinger's equation is an assumption.